Lizzo, Priyanka Chopra Jonas, right? A-Rod. I mean, how do you get Lizzo in the room? And not just in the room, but also on board and invested in your company?
It was a remarkable, path to add such talented folks. When we think about our renters, we really wanted to make sure we were aligning with folks that could help us take our brand to another level and really kind of perpetuate that vision that we hold so dear. And Grammy Award-winning Lizzo was just one of many wonderful folks that we were able to share that story with. And I think for her, it just deeply resonated that connection with home and our business model and our growth. And so, not to mention our profitability profile, became profitable in 2020, which feels a bit like rare air for startups that are pre-IPO. And so, among all those different factors and the fact that this is just such a massive consumer category, a third of the US population rents, and we kind of find ourselves at the intersection of one of life's big decisions, which is where to call home. And I think that, folks like Lizzo, world champion Alex Rodriguez, world champion Andre Iguodala, and Priyanka Chopra Jonas just really love that message and that vision. And it's something that they can get behind, and we're honored to have them as a support for the Series D.
Yeah, and you talk about reaching that profitability. I also know you talk about having seen an uptick in those short-term rental agreements, those short-term leases, 6 months or less. A lot of that driven by people moving to cities that are able to work remote. A lot of that driven by people who are trying to figure out what their next move is going to be post-pandemic. And I guess my question is that a reliable sector, that short-term lease? Do you see that continuing post-pandemic, or is that sort of a short-term phenomenon that we're just seeing for the time being?
Yeah, Brandon, you're touching on something that's really important here because we're really seeing the rise of mobility and work from home has been such a major driver in the transformation about where folks are willing to call home. And we've seen a migration from some of the most expensive cities in America. San Francisco rents are down 27%. We have some friends that have moved twice during the pandemic to improve their living situation at a lower cost. New York City is down 22%. Cities like Miami only down 4%. And then most of the suburbs are actually increasing. And so you're seeing just this kind of shift to get out of the metropolitan areas, to get to a backyard where you have some space, and it doesn't feel as claustrophobic as living in a condensed metropolitan area. And so, for us, we think work from home is here to stay. We at Apartmentless, we're a virtual first company now, and we take great pride in redefining the fabric of our culture in a virtual environment. And so, I think that we're going to continue to see that across America with lots of companies. And I think that's a really unique dynamic that is going to have a major impact on housing for many years to come. And so, the other impact of coronavirus, while it's been so tragic on a global level, we really found out that people are still willing to make those considered purchases, those big life decisions of where to call home. They're willing to do that still in a pandemic, even given the uncertainty and the safety concerns of trying to move in the midst of something so serious, which was, I think, refreshing for us to see from a consumer standpoint that people were still willing to make those moves, even in this type of environment.
And so it sounds like you're still relying on that sort of move to the suburb, even with your sort of your business model. I know a lot of people are talking about what will happen when people head back to the city. Are you expecting people to head back to the city as renters en masse, or do you think, the uptick in home purchases that we've seen because of record low mortgage rates is something that might deter those or might shuffle up those numbers?
Yeah, Brandon, I think we're just seeing the beginning of this mobility change as people try to change their living environments because most renters are signed up on 12-month leases. And so when you think about that dynamic, not everyone had their lease kind of come up for renewal over this last 6 months in the worst of the pandemic. And so what I believe we're going to see is 2000 21 will continue to bring a lot of mobility. You know, one of the most interesting facts I was speaking with our chief economist, Igor Popov, yesterday about was over the last decade, July 2020 was actually the highest search volume month of any month in the last 10 years. And that is just remarkable, given what we're seeing with the pandemic and the impact that's had on our economy and across the world. And so, you know, to see that continued mobility, we think it's definitely going to be here, that liquidity in the rental marketplace for several years to come. And then overall, you know, will people move back to metropolitan areas? I think we'll see the rise of public transportation expanding out into those suburbs as people do want that freedom. They have the latitude with a work from home environment. So I think we're going to see systemic change. And I think it's going to be a really exciting decade when you think about what that means for the housing environment.
Well, and I'm curious, as people do head back, right, say demand returns and people head back to the cities, all these changes that you're talking about do happen. What makes me, when I open up my web browser, type in, you know, apartmentlist.com, as opposed to maybe some of your other competitors that others know?
Yeah, you know, one of the key drivers of our business model is this relentless focus on doing one thing incredibly well. And that thing is we only get paid when a family finds a home. And so we've completely aligned incentives from the supply side, which are listings that come from property managers and owners across the United States, to the demand side, which are renters looking for a place to call home. And so at that intersection is where we sit. And so, you know, we really focus on making it an AI-driven, an algorithmic-driven expected value search result that we basically want to prioritize the listings that we think are the highest likelihood to match for that renter. And so there's a lot of heavy duty math going on behind the scenes, but a very simple business model. We're really getting paid if we actually deliver on helping find that home to that family. And so, you know, I think that's the most unique thing about our business is we have that one revenue stream. We relentlessly focus on building that and trying to make it as strong as possible. And so every time we add more inventory and more supply across America, and every time we add more renters, it increases the number of families that are finding their home through the platform. And so, you know, I think the most important thing to know if you're a renter or an owner or manager looking to advertise on Apartment List is we're only going to get paid if we do our job. So we're here, we're in it with you, and we're excited to be in that role. And it's what gives us energy and optimism every time, you know, we come into work.
Well, and I'm curious about that in terms of your plan, you know, 5, 10, 15 years out, as you consider possibly going for an IPO. But I want to be more specific about that question, because I know there are a lot of tech innovators within the rental market and the housing space, right? We have companies like, albeit different, Rhino, that are looking to reshape the way that security deposits work for renters. We have companies that are going to allow us to have platforms where landlords can be reviewed and then that information used by renters. Have you taken into consideration any other players in the space, or is it, you know, still too early on to think about how those companies factor into your plan?
You know, I think what you're pointing out is there's been kind of a bright light shine on the rental ecosystem, and that's not lost on us. You know, we pay a lot of attention to all the companies that work almost as connective tissue between all of those moves. And so the average American family moves 11 times in their lifetime. Six of those are in the first 12 years after you graduate either high school or college. And so every other year, essentially, you're moving into a rental. And, you know, we've built our business on what we believe to be the highest ROI piece of this entire value creation, which is the move itself. And so that becomes a great jumping off point to add other products and services to help consumers along that journey. And that's what we are really excited to do. You know, we're going to be opportunistic. I think there's a lot of partnership opportunities. There's a lot of M&A opportunities. But I think the thing that we really hang our hat on is we focus so much on doing that one thing so well that now it's an opportunity for us to kind of visit the other properties that are out there in the ecosystem, these great companies with awesome founders that, you know, are building big things and see if any of those are a good fit with our model to try to elevate what we're trying to do and increase the lifetime value of the consumers on our platform.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.